So a superconductor is a material which conducts electricity perfectly without any resistance. It also perfectly banishes magnetic fields, so that no magnetic field can penetrate into a superconductor. There are quite a few applications for them. So some that already exist are they're used in all MRI scanners in hospitals, magnetic resonance imaging. They're used generally to build very powerful magnets. So they're used, for example, for magnetic levitation of trains above tracks. The fastest train in the world at the moment is in Japan, and it uses this technology. They're also used, for example, to accelerate particles to near the speed of light in CERN. So the big problem with them is that the cases we understand only work at very low temperatures, roughly below 40 degrees centigrade above absolute zero, so much, much colder than room temperature. So that's kind of holding back additional applications. The highest temperature superconductors we know of become superconducting only a little bit above the boiling point of liquid nitrogen. So they do have applications already, but they would have many more applications if we could get them up to room temperature. For example, we could use them in power lines and other uses where we'd need to conduct electricity without any resistance. So the thing about conducting electricity without resistance that is so useful is that, for example, to take a kind of wild idea, you could imagine covering the Sahara in solar panels and sending the electricity out all around the world without losing any along the way. With current technology, if we use normal metals to conduct electricity, we necessarily lose a lot of it on the way. In fact, I calculated that in the United States alone, every year, the amount of energy that's lost in transmitting the electricity from where it's generated to where it's used would be enough to power the streetlights of Manhattan for 1,000 years. So that's every year that amount of energy is lost. So the low-temperature superconductors we understand incredibly well. I'd say it's probably one of our best theories in all of physics. So they were first discovered in 1911, and in 1956, I think it was, the theory of how they worked was explained by Bardeen, Cooper and Schrieffer. So it's called the BCS theory of superconductivity. And it's an incredible theory. It predicts many of the phenomena that have been seen, and also new phenomena that were quickly tested. So we understand that very well, but that theory tells us that they can't possibly exist above about 40 degrees C, above absolute zero. So it was a complete surprise when in 1984 another group found a material that theory says couldn't possibly superconduct, in fact does, and does it at much higher temperatures. A lot of progress has been made in terms of the experimental approach to discovering high temperature superconductors. So after that initial find, if you were to plot a graph of highest temperature achieved versus time, you'd see that we jump from the low temperature ones, there's a big jump up to this new type of high temperature, and then the highest temperature increases with time because we found a lot of related compounds to that initial discovery. And then a totally different family of superconductors was found in a different material. So we have this sort of process of going up and eventually petering out, and then a totally new species, perhaps starting with a lower temperature initially, but shooting up to a higher value. And this has happened a few times now. So you see this repeated process of discovering a whole family, and the temperature is creeping up each time this happens. I'm speaking from a biased point of view as a theoretical physicist myself, but I would say that a theory of high temperature superconductivity is the most pressing subject in condensed matter physics, and one of the biggest questions in all of physics. And it would, if we understood how they work, we could probably quite easily predict which classes of materials would superconduct at room temperature and higher. So we would instantly get many practical applications. So guessing new material groups is tricky. I don't know the magic that experimental physicists do to find these new materials. I think there's an element of guesswork there. From a theoretical point of view, I can say that from the discovery of low-temperature superconductors in 1911, it took about 40 years or so until the theory was understood. The first high-temperature superconductors were discovered in the mid-80s, and so it's pretty much the time now that we would expect to be coming up with a theory if you made just the simple assertion that it would take the same length of time. So we can be quite hopeful that we might make that discovery soon. Okay, so some practical applications that are in the very near future, I think, actually are creating power lines out of high-temperature superconductors, because that's actually already being done. In Essen in Germany, they have power lines that use superconductors, and they're buried underground rather than going above ground, so they can be cooled. They're already being produced for use in various places in the United States. One of the really appealing applications that's upcoming is that the engineering is underway to connect up three major power grids in the United States, the East Coast, the West Coast, and Texas. And this process of coupling those three grids would allow the power to be balanced across the country, because of course they're in different time zones and so on. So demand is different at different times. And it turns out to be much more energy efficient to couple those grids using a superconductor in one place. You really need to pass them into one region and couple them. The amount of energy you would use dissipating the heat out of that area from normal currents turns out to be a lot more than it would be if you cooled down a superconductor to it. And of course, one of the major upcoming applications is likely to be quantum computing. So some of the most promising routes to making scalable, useful quantum computers employ superconductors. So the topic of superconductivity is one of various different topics I discuss in my recent book, The Magic of Matter, Crystals, Chaos, and the Wizardry of Physics, which introduces the broader subject of condensed matter physics and shows some of the applications and also why the subject is a rather magical one.